talk, and rock radio, where friends meet at the intersection of life, inspiration, and music. Here's your host, Rick Kern.
Welcome, everyone, to Talk and Rock Radio. My guests today have a combined total of over 200 years of musical experience. I know. They really look good for their age, though, don't they? Welcome from Mill Valley, California, Daryl Adams. From Tempe, Arizona, Jack Barrett. From Las Cruces, New Mexico, Doug Adams. And back in El Paso, Ronnie Evans. This is the Caravels and Kite Band Reunion. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hey.
Oh.
Hey, we can see Jack now.
Yeah.
All right.
Really? Sweet. Wow. I wonder what I did.
This is Jack in a very long time.
Well, you look good. All three of you look really good.
Oh, gee.
You look
which three is he talking about?
Yeah, exactly.
You look the same, Jack.
Well, I'm the same, except I got a bad cold today.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Nah, it'll go away.
Well, anyway, let's kick this thing off, guys. I want to first find out the Caravel group. What year did it start? And where were you all playing most of the time?
Ron, I think you should take the lead on this because you...
Oh, yeah.
Ron, really, I was the... got us together. I think Ron has to take credit for bringing this constellation of people together.
So, you know, Jack and I had been friends. We'd known each other since preschool and started hanging out in grade school. We were in the band together. Both of us played drums, school band. Then I met Doug when I moved to Coronado. And actually, I'd known Doug and Daryl at Trinity Methodist Church. We'd actually seen each other before then. So we got together in Coronado in about seventh grade, started singing together, actually got a couple of gigs. We got one famously at a friend's house when we had no drummer, playing Wipeout, no less, which was a feat of true skill. So we thought, hey, you know, we're pretty good. So we need to get a drummer and get with it. So I said, well, I know this guy, Jack Barrett, you know, I've known him a long time. He's a really good drummer, but he's in a band and I don't know if he's going to want to, you know, stop this gigging band. So I know we asked him to play at a gig and Jack was like, well, okay. So we played, and from that point on, we started doing three-piece until we added Daryl when Daryl came on and started playing bass. And that was, we were still, what, eighth or ninth grade at that point, I think, because we didn't last long without a bass player. It was very limiting. But mostly, I think the fun part is we started as friends and then played music. So it made the bond a lot stronger, you know, when we played together. There's a lot of nonverbal communication because we'd known each other for a while before then.
So how long did the group last, Ron? How many years were you all together?
Until we were about four, I was about 14 or so. I think the freshman year in high school is when we probably stopped, the end of our freshman year in high school. Sophomore year, we started doing different things. We played the big talent shows at Coronado.
Remember, those years were very long. So we were together maybe years, like a day to now.
I can say, do you all remember us playing in South El Paso at some kind of store and we were in the
Ropa Usada
apartment?
Yeah, I remember that. It was, you know, actually really between all of the bins, I guess, that had the clothes in them. And it was like 3 feet on each side.
What did we get? It was that the stands. Stands Ropa Usada.
And how did we get that
apartment?
So how did they pay you for that gig? How much, what kind of money did you make for that one? I wonder.
Paid about 40 pounds of used clothing each.
I think Jack got us that gig. Jack was the gigmeister. He always had the connections.
Well, some of the photos that you guys, I think you sent them to me, Daryl, are just priceless. And I'm going to be putting up photos throughout this episode, not today, but when I do the post edit. And some of those were out on the streets of downtown El Paso. And I know some of them were in a different group that we're also going to be talking about. But the early photos, I mean, there's one of you in there, Doug, that, I mean, golly, did you start playing as soon as you crawled out of the crib or what?
I started playing rock and roll when I met Ron. It's that we were, like you said, we were in the same church and we went to the same school. He sat just behind me and to the right in a history class in the seventh grade. And one day he told me, I hear you play guitar. I have no idea how he heard that, because at the time I knew maybe 2.5 chords. I was struggling through the Peter, Paul, and Mary songs. But we set up a time to go over to his house after school, and got there. He had an electric guitar, 2 acoustic guitars, stacks of records, and he started playing a Beatles song. It's called All My Lovin'. And when we got to the chorus, I broke in with a harmony right off the bat, because I'd been singing in choir since I was about in third grade. And we hit that harmony and our ears lit up. And then he said, okay, first thing you have to do is learn a bar chord. and really started teaching me how to play guitar, and we worked from there until, like he told the story, we added Jack, and then he says, we need a bass player. I go, we do? And I said, well, I bet my brother could do that. And so Daryl came in not only with the bass, but with another voice singing harmonies too. We've spent a lot of time working out those 3-part harmonies.
Well, I can tell you that you guys, and this guy right here, this one I'm pointing at, you can't see my finger. It's opposite, it's mirrored here. Ron Evans, I tell you what, I go so far back. I don't remember how far it was, but I think the first time I heard him, I was literally blown away, because I'm going, he's one of El Paso's real jewels. You know, he always has been, and I've always had the utmost respect for him. Well, his whole family, his dad was my mom's doctor for many years, and Fred, his brother, and I are still to this day good friends. We, you know, go back way, way, way back through our Lions Club work and everything. But I always remember every time I saw Ronnie Evans play, it was with good guys around him. You know, everybody wanted to play with him, you know? So, and I don't know, did you play at Smokestack Banana with that group, Ron?
Yeah, I started that band also.
I think that was probably the very first group I saw you play with. And like I said, one of the groups I remember the most, and you always were so good. So I had to say that, because I've never said it to you before, but I wanted to say it for this, because I'm kind of echoing what Doug was saying about being taught, you know, and you were definitely a guy that could do the teaching for sure.
Well, you know who I taught from? I taught from Mr. Edwards on Yandell. I took from him, I mean, and he taught me some guitar lessons. But after the Caravels, Mike Ciccarelli took me under his wing and really taught me how to play. And I learned a lot from him. He pretty much mentored me for about a year, and it made a big difference in my guitar playing.
You could have done a lot worse than Mike Ciccarelli.
Yeah, let me tell you, he was great. He said, I've been watching me out there in the crowd stealing my licks, so I'm going to teach you how to do them for real.
Similar experience.
He's a great guy.
In my last band out in California, it was called Tapestry, and this was 78, right before I got off the road, but we had this guy coming in to hear our band night after night. He would sit right in front of our guitar player, Danny Miller. And it was Robin Zander from Cheap Trick. And he would come in and we'd take a break and he'd go over and get Danny off to the side and he'd say, hey, can you show me how you played that lick and show me this other thing? And the guy, poor guy couldn't even get his break. You know, next thing we know, we're going back up on stage and he's been standing there all that time telling this guy how to play. But, and here's Cheap Trick still playing today and I'm back in El Paso. What's wrong with this picture? But anyway, it's what happened. You know, okay, so I know Doug's got a story to tell, because one of the things that I saw that just blew me away when I saw that picture was you guys had the coolest band outfit of any band of that era that I've ever seen. Talk about it, Doug, that really cool outfit. I don't know where you had them made. Were they made in Juarez, or where'd you get them made, man?
We probably got everything down close to the border in El Paso. We would actually go looking for stuff where in close to the Ropa Usada store that we, and I think the one you're talking about was a gig at the Elks Lodge. The Elks Lodge for a while was a venue. Rock and roll bands played there regularly. But the first time that I think that happened was when we played at a talent show. We signed up for this talent show. We were really young. This was one of our first gigs. And there was baton twirlers and piano players and a magician and a ventriloquist and a oom-pa-pa band. And they all played. We got up and did a song by Ray Charles, if you could imagine these 13-year-olds and 15-year-old from Coronado doing Ray Charles. And we did a song that we wrote. Then we waited in the audience for the winners to be announced, and they announced the third place winner, not us. They announced the second place winner, and I thought, well, we're out. They're not going to let a rock and roll band take first place. But we did. We got first prize. We won $100. That was $25 each. And that started my career in music. Sometimes I make even more than that now.
Now, was that Elks Lodge, the one on Brown Street over there near Sierra?
That's the one. And after that, it was really great because that seemed to open something up. Everybody was so excited about rock and roll that they hired us to come back and play for a dance. And then that became a venue for all the local bands.
Yeah. I remember those gigs. I think we played there a couple times when I was playing with another group. It brings back crazy memories since you brought it up. I hadn't thought about it in so many years, you know, but it was a lot of fun. So talk about the rat hole. One of the pictures that you sent me, Daryl, it had the rat hole on there. The only thing I ever remember the name rat with was the Rathskeller, but I don't know about the rat hole. What is that?
Well, I don't know as much as these other guys, but it was kind of a, I don't know if you'd call it a dive or just a shed or whatever, but it was a place that went for rent down across Donovan from Zach White, as I recall. And I think it was mostly West Side people that would get that. And we'd play there a few times. It looks from that picture like we were really high up on something. I don't know how that would work out, but I think they used to have fights there and that kind of stuff. I don't remember.
Okay, I got to clear up something here. You said really high up. Does that mean really high or really high up?
Hey, we were like pre-teens at that point.
Oh, okay.
So that place, you could rent it, and it was, I'm sure, completely illegal. And the plus about renting that place for, you know, $20 or something, was that there was absolutely no supervision and no chaperones. So it got pretty rough and tumble sometimes.
Yeah.
It's still there, actually.
Is it?
Yeah.
Interesting. Interesting. Now, the group, the Caravels, you obviously morphed into the Kite group. And I think that's probably when you, let's see, That's when you joined, Ronnie, because y'all had Cancellari in the first group, right? As lead guitar.
Well,
with the Caravels.
When the Caravels, we were in high school, actually junior high when we started. We played on into the first years of high school, and then we broke up and went separate ways doing different things. And then around 1971 or 72, I would think, Kite got, that was like our second year in college for those of us were going, and we just got back together. You know, I said, let's get the band together. And we regrouped as older people and tried again.
Yeah, we had some great names too. We had one that was a Baccharis, which somebody thought we were Tobacco Lip or a Back Rub. And then Jack had this vision, you see, where a man on a magic carpet came and told him our band was called Kite. In reference to the higher up at that point, we were definitely the latter, not the former.
Yeah, that Abacariff thing, I think the one and only gig we played there was at the Coliseum opening for somebody, but I can't remember who.
Rare Earth, I think.
Or Buddy Rivers, maybe. But when the DJ who was announcing us completely fumbled and stumbled and couldn't pronounce our name, we thought we need to get something that could be pronounced by human tongue.
Yeah.
Speaking of names,
that name was China Berry backwards.
Oh, that's really funny.
can I tell you something about these names?
Yeah.
The names. Okay. I was just looking this up before on the air. The Caravels. A caravel is a small, fast Spanish or Portuguese sailing ship from the 15th through 17th centuries. And its origin is from the French caravel, from the Portuguese caravela, diminutive of caravo, which is from the Latin, which is from the Greek, carabos, which means horned beetle.
Or horny, maybe. I'm not sure which.
But beetles, there we were. We didn't know we are diminutive beetles or light ship. And then kite, of course, is definitions, a toy with a light frame of thin material stretched and flown in the wind at the end of a long string. But a kite is also a medium to large, long-winged bird of prey, which has a forked tail and frequent birds on upstairs drafts of air, the American swallow. So with these great names, I want to know why the artist we hired, when we told him to make us a bumper sticker, it's hot dog.
Yeah. You know, what's funny is that odd juxtaposition really tweaked people's minds and made them think about it, because it's like, well, wait a minute, what does a hot dog have to do with a kite? What is that? They were all over East Texas for a while.
We had bumper stickers made, and the artist put our name, Kite, which is all we asked. But with free reign as an artist, he put us on a hot dog. And they were everywhere. People, they may still be some hot dog kite stickers stuck up in Austin somewhere.
You know, Doug, when you sent me this morning your Caravel business card, I immediately thought, wow, you know, that's what we did back in those days. We all had business cards with our name on it. So I immediately went into my 26,972 photos on my phone, not to be outdone by the one and only Doug Adams with his business card from the 60s. And I found mine. So I'm going to put it up. When I put a picture of your card up, I'm going to put mine right next to yours, and it'll have The Basic Sound, Jim Reese, Rick Kern, Gail Hageman, Dick Greco. I'm glad you shared that with me, though, because, yeah, that's how we promoted ourselves back in the days, you know?
Music for all.
We were wild promoters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I liked what you said on there, we'll work reasonably or something to that effect. I don't remember what it was, but I thought, does that mean you would work for food also, or was
it? Underwear.
Clean underwear.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
We
crazy stuff.
We enjoyed the promotional part of it. Daryl or Jack, tell them about the our trip to Memphis.
Jack, you do that because I know you were interested in it.
Which was in the paper.
Is that the photo where you're getting on the plane?
Yeah.
Okay. Tell us, Jack.
Well, I used to like buy Lear jets that had been crashed or wrecked. And no, that's not true. We were going to go to Memphis. And so I had this idea we could go to the airport and we'd all have like a bag in our hand or something like that. And they park Lear jets over there at the private airport part. And so we went over there and there's one parked right there with the ladder down and everything. So we all got in line like we're getting onto the plane. And I think it was Darla that took the picture, wasn't it?
I don't know.
Anyway, Rich, someone took a picture of us doing that, and it was really neat looking picture. And the I guess it was El Paso Times did an article on us going to Memphis to record, and we gave them that picture, and they put that picture in there like we were had our own Learjet or something to go to Memphis to record or something. Anyway, it was pretty neat picture, and. There's quite a few comments about that over the years.
You should tell them how we really got there.
How did we really get it? I don't remember.
Was it like a Cessna five-seater or something?
No, it was a
red Araguay's van, I think.
Oh. Yeah,
we actually got there in a, it was a long trek.
Oh, my gosh.
We went.
I think that was the time. Oh, go ahead, Doug.
We went there in Econoline vans and, with bald tires, but we had the picture of us boarding the Learjet with our guitar in our fancy rock and roll leather jackets too.
Yeah,
that's cool. You know, I was just thinking about you guys since you all went to Coronado together. Was Karen Burke there at that same time?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
She lived right up the street from us on DeSoto in Coronado Hills.
Ah, cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. Well, you know, when she was the MC for my very first Border Legend show in 2009, she and Taylor came in, and it was so great. And she did a song with my guitar player, Sam Stevenson, called, was it Juarez? No. Oh, 1 Mile Away, I think, was the name of it. And the song is about this house where she lived, and it is... writing about true life, you know, how she lived in very upwardly mobile, you know, upbringing and everything in this nice home up on the mountain. And then Sam is singing the part of the Hispanic guy that lives in an adobe house across the border. Wow. And it's really an emotional song. I mean, Sam, you could tell he was really getting kind of teared up when he sang it. But she asked me, she said, I would love to do this song when I come, and do you have a guy that could sing the part of a Hispanic? I said, I've got Sam Stevenson, you know, and he'll do a great job. And he did. It was really, really quite good. But I had to throw that in there because I was thinking about you guys. And of course, that goes to my next question about, Royal Music. When you guys went over there to record with Taylor and Kenny Smith, that must have been a pretty fun experience for you all.
It was great.
Yeah.
Those guys.
Yeah, we didn't really know any much about recording at the time. I think Doug and Daryl, probably Daryl, had contacted Kenny about it. And we went and kind of did a demo there. And he liked some of the songs. And we ended up recording what he thought were the best ones, I guess. Anybody else?
The studio had a good pedigree. I think it was it Royal Studios or Royal, but it was
Royal Studios, yeah.
Where
Royal
Al Studios. Green recorded. Al Green recorded a lot of his stuff there with Willie what was his last name? The producer.
Mitchell.
Willie Mitchell. Yeah, who's pretty much, you know, famous in that area of the country. And but it was an old movie theater, and it had drapes hung all down the side. And at our end, they had gotten a new bunch of equipment up in the projection room. And I think it was an all MCI setup. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, 24 track, and then down at the other end,
16.
That sounds better too. Willie Mitchell had, I think it was an 8-track down at the other end, and the drums were in the booth, you know, where you get that funky, probably drum sound that's been on 1,000 records. And the, it's like, I'm not going near that, because you bump a microphone a half inch and it's going to screw everything up. But it was fun seeing it.
That must have been a fun experience for you guys being in Memphis, because there's just so much history there with Sun and Stax Records and everything that's there. You know, did you all bounce around in any of the other studios while you were there, or was it just all business and get out?
Yeah, we'd somebody else should talk, but we got in there in the evening and recorded till the sun came up, pretty much in their downtime.
Yeah, when I talked to Taylor last time, he was telling me, because we were talking a little bit about Swift Rain, you know, because this is their 50-year anniversary this year. In fact, Andre and I are going to be doing an episode on it. And I said, well, tell me some fun stories about when those guys came over there and recorded it, you know, at Royal with you all. And he said, well, he says, I do remember one day, he said, I think we went through about 18 bottles of Boone's Farm, you know.
Sounds typical.
Yeah. Good cheap wine, I guess. You know, I mean, it couldn't have been Thunderbird or Rio Nitti. It had to be, you know, Boone's Farm.
Yeah.
That, no, right? Does it? I don't really remember.
I don't remember getting any wine there, but we might have.
Well, you know what they say, if you remember it in the 60s, then you weren't there,
right?
So that's all I'm going to say about that.
One thing I remember about recording there is that we did the tracks live except for the vocals, and maybe a few Sweetener tracks after that. But for the most part, the tracks were recorded with all four of us playing at once. And since they didn't want to do the vocals so you could get a nice clean sound, we would just be playing these songs as instrumental. We knew them well enough that we could do that and not get lost. But with the nervousness and the repetition of several takes, the tempos would creep up. Mm. By the time we had to sing them, it became a real challenge to spit syllables out. They got going really fast.
Yeah, the one that I had to sing live was Diamond Lil.
Oh,
yeah. I played the piano. They had the piano stuck in this little cubby hole and the vocal mic on it. So I was multitasking for a junior piano player at that time.
Diamond Lil would do anything for a thrill. Even cheating on her man Bill. Bill swore
talk about the backstory to that song. What's your inspiration on that one?
You know, it's like most songwriting. I was banging around some moody chords, I think, and thinking about, you know, we're here in El Paso in the Wild West, and a little bit of the Beatles' Rocky Raccoon thrown in there, and just one thing after another, kind of a dark little tale now that I look back on it. Seemed fine to me at the time, but it definitely is a story. You know, I was taking a class from C.L. Sonicson at the time, who was a well-known Western historian.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, and he's a historian, you know, world historian. And I think some of the tales that he was telling about people got woven into my head at that time. But besides the story, it was just me trying to write a pop song, basically.
Well, and the story is really good because it rings true with the history of those days. You know, I'm real good friends with Bernie Sargent and Melissa, and they're part of the Six Gun Shady Ladies group. And I'm anxious for them to hear that song because I think it's going to ring true with what they do with their reenactments and stuff that they do. It's really good. It's a good song. I really like it a lot.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
The song Flying, Doug, talk about that one a little bit, man. Where did that inspiration come from?
Well, where that first started coming to me, the music, was I put an acoustic guitar in an open D tuning, or mostly open D tuning, drop D, and was really playing it, thinking like Richie Havens. You listen to those old Richie Havens recordings, I think he might have had a 12 string, but he just had hand percussion. And the bass, the rhythm guitar just was really driving the rhythm. Where that came about. As far as the lyrics, I don't know, you'd have to ask the person who wrote it, and I'm not him anymore.
So, that was a different lifetime, right?
I think that sounds the most like us when we were live. Flying does what really? We sounded like live. Yeah, it's I know. What do you guys think? You think the same thing?
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, yeah. The others, the Diamond Lil and Carry Me, are both beautiful songs, but they wouldn't have gone over in the Silver Poodle.
that's a point I was going to make about the two different contrasts of songwriting there. You know, I think that's what's really cool about this group and the writing talent that I'm seeing with this combination that I'm looking at here, is that on Flying, I'm really enjoying what you're doing, Jack, on the drums. It's really good. You've got some nice, really cool riffs in there. And I was studying mentally as I'm listening to the song. I'm watching myself doing what you're doing. And And I'm going, wow, that's cool. I like what he did there. And yeah, and how do you remember that he, you know, I mean, it was obvious that you'd played the song many times before you went in there to record that, right?
Right.
Yeah, it was quite good. But back to what I was saying, the writing contrast between you, Ron, and Doug are so different, but they're so complementary at the same time. You know, they're just two textures of two different styles of writing. You're more mellow, and here's Doug in this, you know, getting after it, you know, and kind of raw. You know, I really liked it a lot, you know. Yeah, really good mellow stuff.
Mellow with a murderous intent, apparently, 2 out of 3 of the songs. But, you know, Doug and I were and are great friends. So, you know, we got together, we were definitely Beatle nuts. And so in the model of McCartney and Lennon, we were always egging each other on, you know, to be influenced by and encourage and kind of compete sometimes to write songs. And he'd write something really great. And I'd go, wow, that's great. That's and it would influence the next thing I tried to do and vice versa. It was a real partnership.
You can really hear that in your writing style, Ron, because I'm hearing Beatles, I'm hearing Journey, I'm hearing a little bit of, you know, of each in both of those, you know, in Carry Me and in Diamond Lil.
And you know, all of us, I think all of us had something to do with the sound of it, because yeah, I'd write the song or Doug would write it, but you know, we did it Beatles style where we'd come in and get together and one person would say, yeah, but try this and then try that. And they would take the raw song. And by the time we'd all played it together, it became kind of what it became. I really appreciate the input from the other three, because it definitely, like if you listen to the thought behind the drums, behind bass lines that Daryl played, and the harmonica, for example, in Diamond Lil is so haunting, you know, all of that stuff changes just a song I wrote on a piano into something with a lot of depth and feeling to it.
That piano work at the beginning, I had this visualization of a guy sitting there in a honky tonk bar, sitting at his piano. And that's the feel that I'm getting from this. And I can just visualize it. So it's just perfect. You know, it's just so good. So you nailed it, man. You really did. You nailed it really well.
Oh,
okay, Doug, you're up, man. Talk about the Blizzard.
Oh, I just wanted to say, in response to you talking about Jack's drum parts and Ron mentioning Daryl's bass parts, is we practiced a lot. We really, and it went back to when we were, you know, just kids in high school. We were also all in the school band for a while. We knew what it meant to practice and to practice together. And we would grow the parts, and then we played a lot and we performed a lot, and they would evolve. And everybody really brought a lot of themselves into that group in a way that I've really experienced very rarely, though I've played with, you know, hundreds of different combinations of people since then. The Blizzard. Okay, the Blizzard was about the end of a relationship, a definitive end. And I really did leave in the middle of the night, in the middle of the snowstorm in El Paso, and I had no car.
I sure hope that the blizzard don't come, 'cause I'm out on the road traveling by the this time of night, no one stops you. I sure hope that the snow don't fall, 'cause I can't see anyone at all who can give me any shelter till the blizzard is through. This time of night it just isn't right for any man or beast to be running in fright. No beast or man is near the wind to be. It's true what they say about a woman's scorn, it can level the land just like Joshua's horn. Walls come crumbling down in the same way. It's never been that way around here. I'll run free on some distant seashore. Any given day, my soul is gonna fly away.
What were you thinking?
Oh, I was thinking, I want out of here. And I did. And that was it. It was the first lines of that song is, I sure hope that the blizzard don't come because I'm out on the road traveling by thumb. And so that was pretty much, you know, just a little statement of what had happened by the time I got to a warm place with a guitar. I did rewrite the last verse, though. That's one song that I still will perform. And the last verse now, it was something about there will never be any peace if your anger is released. And like, you don't want all that anger bottled up inside you. So the new ending, I wish you peace. I wish you gold. I wish you all the love that your heart can hold. But I'd rather travel out into the cold than stay.
I love it. That's good, man. Good writing. I love that. There's a photo of you guys that every time I see it, I'm so intrigued. It's one that you all took from the top of the Plaza Theater. First of all, how did that come about happening and why up there? Somebody.
You mean the one inside and the
No, the one up on the roof.
Oh, I don't know.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, it's the one with the wind blowing as a flagpole. And I think it's, you know, we were looking for locations and, you know, the Plaza's always been kind of a big deal in El Paso. And so we were El Paso boys and we were looking for interesting locations to take pictures. And that was one of them. We went to Sunset Heights, I think, that day, and the park downtown. And, you know, we were just a bunch of goofballs looking for fun stuff to take pictures and get promo. We were crazy promoters. We did the craziest things, anything to get people's attention.
And you had some really cool clothes on that day too. I think one or two of you had like a top hat or something and some real dark jackets and stuff. Looked like a scene out of a Christmas Story or something, you know. Just, it's pretty cool, you know.
I think that picture you're talking about was on the top of the Del Norte Hotel.
Oh, mm-hmm. It wasn't the Plaza. Okay.
Well, we took pictures in the Plaza, but
yeah,
took them all over the place.
That was a
photographer, Richard Barron.
Oh, yeah.
Richard. Yeah.
I believe he's recently passed away in the last couple of years, but his brother is still in El Paso, the artist Ho Barron, sculptor. And he just got his camera gear and followed us around. And we went downtown and up hotels and maybe in the Plaza Theater, Sunset Heights. And got a lot.
One of those photos, you all were standing on a street downtown. And I remember seeing the sign up there, pawn shop. I don't remember what else it said. It said pawn shop, loans, and I was kind of curious. I guess it was just a promo shot you all were shooting, but you're all standing right there. It was a vertical shot. Looked pretty cool. Yeah.
I think that was across from Benny's Pawn Shop.
Yeah.
You remember Benny's Pawn Shop?
Yeah. Awesome.
Yellow and black.
Benny's Pawn Shop. Yeah. That's the one with Pancho Villa's finger in there, I think, right? It's still for sale. I think they had a price tag of like $5,000 on it, but I think if you went there and offered it, you know, offered $250, you could probably buy it.
No doubt. Yeah.
I think he's sold that several times.
I think I heard a song about that.
I think maybe 30 of those have gone out.
Yeah, he's got a mold in the back room and he just makes these fingers and
Oh, we hope crazy. That's all he did.
Oh, crazy stuff. Well, I want to hear any more stories that somebody wants to share before we wrap this thing up. You know, I know you guys have got some good stories, so, you know, somebody have at it.
I was thinking about our repertoire and, you know, just songs that came to mind. And I remembered a place that a lot of bands played in the 70s, early 70s, was a little bar, I think on Copia Street, called the Silver Poodle. We had a sound and light guy who was with us, who we have to mention is Ray Paraguay, because he was with us on every gig for a very long time. And we had the little light system that was just some, floodlights, colored floodlights. And they worked on the car dimmer switches, because it was supposed to be a foot switch, but he was doing it by beating on them with his fist. And so we'd take a break. And for the second set, we'd come back. The stage would be completely dark. And the place would be packed. It was just stuffed with people. It was not a big place, but you couldn't fit another person in there. It was so stuffed, hot summer nights. We'd sneak back up on the stage and it'd be completely dark. And we'd get on our guitars, turn our amps up as loud as they'd go. Ray would be at the ready with the lights. And then we'd just hit one, whack, just hit one note and he'd flash the lights. It just one chord, Jack would whack the drums. And it was so startling. We wanted to get attention, you know. It was so startling that sometimes somebody would drop a drink, you know, or smack their beer mug on the floor. And we did get cursed out a couple of times from doing that. And then we'd do that again and again, speed them up. And then we'd break into a song. And we did some songs. We did The Hall of the Mountain King by Grade from Peer Gynt Suite. And any other favorite songs from you guys that you remember that we just
enjoyed? 2001 Space Odyssey, remember that? We'd start with that echo. We had an echoplex and we started making weird sort of chanting noises and evolve into that. That was another one. My favorite one was when we did that, we played at some high school and they had a bunch of costumes in a box. So we put on these costumes, like grasshopper costumes and kind of crazy stuff. And they turned the lights on. The principal was unamused, but the kids seemed to like it. It was a pretty fun day.
Yeah, and the Star Wars thing, you know, Don Dungan, Doogie, he and I are pretty good pals. And he told me at the Silver Pool, he said, "You guys were the loudest band I ever heard." We had 4A7s running off a Macintosh power amp, and it was loud, boy.
Yeah. Wow.
One thing that was great was Doug would write some horn parts for some of the songs.
Yeah.
There was a horn section of three or four horn guys that would come and play with us on certain gigs. And it was really, really fun doing that. It just really added so much power to the band.
Who would you get, Doug? Like Marty Olivas and Jimmy and those guys? Or who would you get?
Oh, well, I was going to UTEP, the music department. And so I just went to the band and got some guys who were in there. And these guys had never jammed before. They had never played rock and roll before. These are like orchestral players. And I just wrote out the part. And when it worked, it was really great. I'm so glad you like it, Jack, because
I loved it.
Oh yeah, good. That was great. That was great.
Yeah, when it worked, but a couple of one of the guys really was not up to the rigors of the rock and roll scene when he was plied with alcohol. And,
it takes training, you know.
Yeah, I remember when we were on the road with my second show group. We got this wild hair and we decided that we all wanted all of a sudden to be playing brass with our show. Now this was a trio. This was a trio, and our strong part of our group was our voices. It was really good, you know, tight harmony, and it was keyboard, drums, and guitar. And the keyboard player would play keyboard, bass, and he was good at it, but I picked up the trumpet from a pawn shop and the other two guys had trombones, and we had seen this group in Tahoe where we were playing that played brass instruments. And it sounded so good, you know, that at the intro, and it sounded big and full. And so we thought, yeah, we can do that. Well, let me just tell you, I think it lasted one night. It was so bad. I mean, first of all, it's hard enough to play drums well, but try play drums and playing a trumpet at the same time. It sucks big time. I don't care if you're Herb Alpert, it's not going to sound good and play drums and trumpet at the same time. But so that was short lived, Doug. That was my experience with horns in my band, and it was short lived. Crazy. So Jack, are you playing any more these days?
Yes, I'm still playing. I haven't played the drums very regularly for probably about 20 years. I've been playing piano and synthesizers, and I have several guitars. I play them every day. So I'm getting a little bit better. I like to write songs, and it's kind of hard to write songs on a drum set, if you know what I mean. And I hurt my back really bad, and I just couldn't play the drums much more than I used to.
Yeah, I've got a bad back too. And I think a lot of it was, you know, probably from all that lifting all those years, you know, and just, you know, the body's just takes a beating after a while. You know, I have fond memories of West Hampton Barge, you know, going and hear you guys play at McKelligan Canyon and maybe Cathedral. I'm not sure. Western Playland was always great. For you other three guys, you may not know, but after Jack left, I kind of picked up the duty of playing with the West Hampton Barge for a while, and played several gigs with them. And it was fond memories, because I always would, if I had a night off, I would go and see whoever was playing wherever, you know, and West Hampton Barge was one of them. I do stay in touch with the guys every once in a while. It's been quite a while, but I'll run now and then. I'll give David Karam a call or Teensy, you know, but try to keep the memories alive. How about you, Ron? Are you writing still? Or what are you doing these days, music wise?
Yeah, I do. I've got, I write a bunch of stuff. I've been playing around with GarageBand, believe it or not, on my phone. It's amazing what you can actually do with it. You know, you can have up to 32 tracks. So I kind of, some people read crosswords, but I'll sit around if I have to be somewhere for a while and write and play music. I think I've got like 40 songs on my phone.
That's cool.
It's a lot of fun. I have a Pro Tools here. I'm just now getting it back together since we moved back. I teach, you know, a little bit at New Mexico State. So being in the film business, I teach in the film department there. So I've renovated their theater recently to turn it into a 7-1 mixing theater as well as an exhibition place. And Doug and Daryl joined me up there for a movie night one night. So Jack, you'll have to come in. And yeah. Rick, you're certainly, sometime we'll have a night up there, but yeah, that's what I've been doing with my time, I guess.
I would love that, because when our kids come in from Austin, they're both film involved as well. Our daughter was a film major at UT Austin at one time, and then that ended up, actually started out being an architectural engineer, and then she decided she didn't like math, so that didn't work.
Me too.
But both kids are accomplished musicians, and our son's a photographer for Getty Images, and he's done a lot of video and helped produce independent films and stuff. We all love our movies and we love photography. So we've been at it a long time. And I think my son, he's shot something like 60,000 photos for Getty already. Wow. And how about you, Daryl? Are you writing? Obviously you've got a beautiful studio there. You must be doing some writing.
Yeah, this is just my little music room. Back in the 70s, I started going to UTEP and theory composition courses in music, and got hooked in via a teacher there named Charles Stanley. He was a kind of a visionary, believe it or not, and he had some of the first synthesizers, ARP 2600s and that kind of stuff. So I learned on those and wrote a few things. And then, you know, life happened and I had my kids and pretty much dropped everything at that point. But within the last few years, I've gotten back into the composition stuff, found a really good guy at the local community college. Trevor is his name. And truth be told, he's the best teacher that I've had in anything that I've ever studied. And wow. We have a little composer, I guess you'd call it a salon or gang, and we write stuff. The stuff that I've done so far in this one is more, I guess, you know, I think the word is neoclassical. It's kind of like string quartets and choirs and stuff, but with a more modern bent to it. Had some success. I won a first prize in a statewide contest in California for a string quartet that I did. And wow. Now there's a new thing in music called Eurorack, E-U-R-O, Eurorack. Mm-hmm. And it's the modular synthesizers like the Moogs used to be back in the day, Keith Emerson and that kind of stuff. And I'm thinking about getting back in that and making some more bleeps and bloops and, you know, sound music like that too. So I'm having some fun with that.
I love the ELP stuff back in the day, man. When we were traveling, there was a lot of those groups that were springing up with the new Moog sound and everything. It all pretty neat. Dr. Stanley, that you mentioned, incredible professor. When I was at UTEP, I never took with him, but because my stuff is mainly in the vocal department. But mm-hmm. I did. Hugh Carden was my main professor, and I took private lessons with him. And yeah, those were great days. In fact, that's where I met the two of the guys in my first band we played together 6 nights a week for 4 years. And that was Dick Greco on keyboard and Gail Hageman, who was pretty much a bass player, but a tremendous singer. And all three of us were in the choral department. So that's how we met. The very first day of 1969, you know, in class, we're all three together there. And we met after the class and said, hey, you know, we all play different instruments. Why don't we think about putting a group together? And so, and then Jim Reese was coming back in El Paso from the Bobby Fuller stuff. And then we added him, and it just, you know, it happened pretty well. It was like meant to be, though, out of that music department there. Steve Haddad, I'm sure you know Steve.
Yeah, knows him really well. Yeah.
Yeah, he's a good guy. And you know, I was really glad to see that commercial department start up there, because it's I wish they'd have had it back when I was going to college there, because it teaches all aspects of music, everything from, you know, writing, working in the studio, how to produce, how to, you know, promote, you know, all aspects of music. And nothing like that existed back when we were in college, you know, mm-hmm. So pretty neat stuff.
Yeah. I actually helped Stanley put that little studio together that is in the performance hall of music.
Yeah.
Nice. It's an old Quantum console. It was originally an 8-track Ampex and so on. Yeah. I worked with Charles Stanley well.
Didn't he pass away not too long ago, Ron?
A little while ago, I think.
Yeah.
It's been a few years.
Because I know he was involved with Coronado Methodist, or one of the Methodist churches over there off in the...
It's the one on Thunderbird. It's
Thunderbird, yeah.
Western Hills.
Western Hills. That's it. That was the one. Yeah.
He was a music director there.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Great guy. Yeah. Okay, Doug. So you just got through gigging a couple nights ago. How'd that go, man, over at Star City?
It was fantastic. It was really great. I just did a solo set, except for I had Eric Bozeman come and join me spontaneously on the cajon for a bit, and it went really well. There were two other artists there, and we each did two short sets, and I did something that was a little bit gutsy. I have this song that's a story song. It's really a ballad. It takes about 10 minutes and it's mostly talked. And there's, as you know, there's not many venues where you can do something like that. You really need people's total attention. And they gave it to me. And it was just a really magical night. Next thing I'm going to be doing is working on parts for an album by Gene Keller.
Nice.
Playing some guitar and harmonica and violin parts on that. But I wanted to say before we move on from this section about you were talking about Jack and the West Hampton Barge. Another band Jack was in short after the Barge was Macatouche. And yeah. That was a three-piece, very psychedelic guitar, bass, and drums. And I think probably more than any other ensemble I've heard Jack in, you and Jack, is that because when you have less people, you have more responsibility, but more freedom per instrument. And Jack just really, really developed in that ensemble. It was mighty. It was really just amazing to hear that group.
Who played with you, Jack?
Gary Durr and Pat Garrett.
Oh, gosh. Yes. Okay, great. Two good musicians. Yeah, nice.
And then Ron, he's tossed off his bit about the working on GarageBand on his phone. I've heard some of that stuff. You know, he gives me these little headphones and says, Doug, listen to this. And I hear snippets of it, and it sounds like a movie soundtrack. I go, what is it? And, oh, I did it while I was waiting for a plane in Phoenix.
Yeah, the little intro song that you'll hear on my Talk and Rock, that's one that I wrote. And in it, it's with GarageBand also. It's just so easy to use. I mean, all this stuff is plug-in, you know. And I don't have a MIDI or anything that I play with. I just go and take snippets from other people's stuff and then mesh it all together. And it's all done where, you know, if it's in a specific key, when you go and mesh a different other part with it, it automatically brings it into the right key. It's really cool how it all works. So it's kind of fun stuff to deal with. I don't do the Pro Tools thing because I didn't want to go back to college to learn, you know. So I use pretty much I use iMovie a lot because I can do everything with it. I can do strictly sound, I can do video, I can bring in the edits are a lot, you know, a lot easier. And they've really improved the iMovie from what it used to be. It's kind of like the same thing as GarageBand, very similar, you know. A lot of the people that are in this business now are using the GarageBand platform. They really like it, and it's I have no problem with it, you know. But
it's basically done by the guys who created Logic. So if you have Logic, you can import your GarageBand songs into Logic.
Wow.
And do that kind of stuff. Yeah, there've been a few hit records made in GarageBand, believe it or not.
Yeah. So, amazing technology.
Hey, I had one thing I wanted to throw in there back about the Caravels. Two kind of exciting moments we had. One, we were playing at the Mission Hills neighborhood pool, and Ron had just gotten a Fender Mustang guitar. And the Mexican stations kept coming through his guitar and through the amp, and they were louder than we were when we were playing. So this, you know, it was really weird. Another thing was we were playing at El Paso Country Club, and we were playing for like a big school dance with Coronado, and we were younger than most of the people there. And I'd set my drums up on two cafeteria tables because, you know, like on Ed Sullivan's show, they always had the drummer up on platform. And so right in the middle of a song, those tables just decided to fold up and right on top of me, and it was so embarrassing. But looking back at it, that was really quite a show.
Yeah. Well, you just told everybody, Jack, that this was like the Who. It was all part of the show, right?
Right.
Where you kick the drums off and ram the guitar into the amplifier, the whole bit.
I could have gotten hurt. One of those cymbals could have come and just cut my neck
off,
like that James Bond movie.
Well, one of the photos that I'm going to put up is that Daryl sent me. It looks like the cymbal is cutting your head off. You know the one I'm talking about, Daryl?
Not right off.
I think even in the caption, it said something like, you know, Headless Jack or something, you know?
I don't believe
it. Yeah.
I remember that very moment we were playing at the country club and we were singing House of the Rising Sun. Lead, and I heard this big crashing kaboom, and you know, I just kept singing. But then I noticed that Jack had stopped playing, and I just saw this pile of tables and drums and his arms and legs sticking out from them, waving. And it was very dangerous. Lucky he didn't get hurt, but
yeah, we had to take an unscheduled break for that.
Yeah, I was going to say, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a break right now. You know, we'll be back shortly. So that's pretty funny. Well, I can't think of anything that we haven't covered. Pretty much got it all said, I think. I really appreciate you guys doing this with me today. Any final thoughts?
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Rick.
Yeah, it's fun.
Thank you, guys. And Daryl, thank you for sending me the photos and the music and everything.
You betcha. Yeah, we did that by consensus, but yeah, I mailed him in.
Well, I appreciate it. We really, I enjoyed doing this episode with you guys today, and keep doing what you guys are doing, man. Keep making music and stay healthy and stay happy and have a great holiday season. Okay.
You too, Rick. Thank you, guys.
Okay. You guys take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now. Thanks a lot.